questions. I will give you that E1 brought this team all the way through M1 with the help of that Grocky in his hands. But this is one of those situations where I think it's about 50-50. And I'm leaning a little bit more towards Brand Esports because their composition is very straightforward and you know exactly what it wants to do.
You know what I was thinking for their last pick? Hylos. A Hylos could have reached the back line more. They could have access to it.
Just block the Benedetta.
That could have been the pick, but still, this is their choice. Todak for the anchor. Just went for what brought them victory after victory in M1.
Yeah, with that said, you know, whoever wins this matchup will be meeting Alter Ego. With that, gentlemen, we're going in towards our final game of this best of three. It's either Brand Esports or Toadot that will be advancing forward. And we're already seeing a little bit of a catch up of the eras. Of course, there's a lot of tension on the stage. And certainly on the cast says we've got mixed opinion about the entirety of the draft at this moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely would agree that, again, it's one of those things where it's like, where are we looking for those win conditions? How are we looking to kind of pressure the map here? Because Thorndot has shown that, yes, we can have macro superiority over the map, but if Bren have a good idea of what exactly the draft wants to do, they can easily shut it down with one or two picks in the draft itself, as we saw in game two. So, what kind of situation is this game three looking for?
Definitely is a very big question here, but I'm really thinking for the fact that, you know, Brand Esports now looking pretty tight with that survey lineup that they've drafted, very clear things that they want to execute. And honestly, I'm not really giving too much of a bad remark on that Saloon, because all these games, there's so many great consistent results. Yeah, they might have dropped game number one, but hey, they really were getting all the picks that they need.
Yeah, no, this is the exact way you build a Harley lineup. We've seen Harley lineups in the playoffs, and they all felt compromised. They all felt like, oh, as soon as I pick the Harley, I have to stack on the magic damage. And what do people do? Athena's shield, call it a day, right? But this time around, it felt more ready. It felt more like, okay, this is what we're doing. If we get the deadly magic, okay. If we don't, then we find another way to get in there and finish the job. But this time, I have to say, Contra, I feel exactly like you, but for Brand last game. Like, you're looking at that last pick, Grock, and you're like, I know you're good with the hero, man, but
Yeah, I would say it's a little questionable as well.
I would treat the Harley like a Gushen in a sense. It's a more stable pick, and it doesn't Harley really is, fall yeah. out as much. But if you think about it, when you have a Harley or a Gushen on your team, the other team cannot go for the split push. There's always this chance that a Harley might pop out. Just use deadly magic, just use the cards on you, and just go away, you get popped, and that's it. But one of the reasons why a lot of people don't go for this, especially on the teams, is that you really have to have good early game control. If you get a lot of turtles, if you get your buffs, that's going to be great. But these are the kinds of grabs that if you lose early game, it's really hard to come back from.
Yeah, and definitely the Harley is a lot more stable in the early phase of the game where, you know, he could easily just go in there, chuck in the damage, get out of it safely. So definitely a safer pick as compared to a Gushen that easily could be halted midway.
Yeah. You know, to be fair, I will say that at least for Brand, looking at Todak's lineup and their composition, it's a lot more standardized. Something that they're familiar looking at. You know, the Sylvana, you know exactly what she wants to do. You know exactly what they want to be, where they want to be at level four itself. I think that's going to be, you know, the first benchmark that we're going to have to keep our eyes on at level four for both of these sides. Because again, the pick potential from Todak, really, really high, as well as the disruption. However, just the exponential amount of damage coming out of Brand is ridiculous. Deadly magic, feathered airstrike on top of everything else. Those two alone, on top of everything else they have in their lineup, that's kind of scary here if you're walking alone in the river.
Yeah, and not to mention the Fatal Links from Lusty.
Exactly.
And everybody knows, if you've been watching M2 so far, especially in the group stages, opponents of Todak have banned out Atlas because of how well E1 used it.
Yeah, he could have possibly get this pick
for
himself. And not only that, like I feel like the Tamas pick could have come a little bit later, and even if they ban very unlikely ban out a Tamas, probably a Lapu-Lapu is more likely the case, right? They could have gone for the Baxia as well.
Which,
Honestly, that's why. Like, they actually choose this Tamas on pick number
three. Yeah, could have gone first. Yeah, could have gone first. You're right.
Yeah, the order, again, I don't know. That's why I didn't agree with the blind pick Thabos. Like, I didn't exactly understand what
it was. It was a wasted opportunity.
Almost. But I think, you know, at the end of the day, Thabos has one job, and it's either he's going to be looking to cut those waves, speed up those neutral objectives, or at the very least just start peeling away their opponents. But the problem with Thabos, and I think a lot of the pros kind of understand this, especially after Season 4, where Thabos really started to dip off when a lot of these offlaners came in, was that he could easily be countered the moment you could get a deadly blade, and eventually the Sea Halberd, especially for Hayabusas who had to deal with Thabos's, where it's like, ah, I'm losing the lane, okay, I get the Bloodless Axe, okay, no big deal. Finally, I get the Sea Halberd, okay, I 100% win this matchup.
Yep, and Butters, you know, like, well, we saw some pretty interesting mages coming in towards this draft. Like, who will you pay attention to in this both sides of the lineup?
I guess Moon on the Sylvana has this capability of just building up items. He would be forced to go for the defensive ones. If he has an early start, then that means he could build into the concentrated energy, probably a Crunchon or two. It could be one of the things that they need to look at. Flock of Destiny is there as well, but it could be optional. Like, if you really have a good game, you can start out with that so that you can get the benefits of. On the other side, it's going to be the Harley, because Harley is in the heart and soul. Is the heart and soul of this three mage setup. When you get the magic resistance, when you put it on, that's going to mean an Abyssal Arrow will hurt more, an Abyssal Trap will hurt more. Feathered Airstrike is going to hurt much, much more. And seeing how this two team plays, you really have to look at how they make or how they initiate their team fights. Game number one, Toadak showed us that they're really good in terms of the team fight. Teamwork makes the dream work for them at game number one. Game number two, they showed there a bit of the tenacity of Bren Esports. They just showed you that even in the weirdest of lineups, they will still try to find a way to make it up on top. Game number three, With Atlas and Blusty just being there for his team, I think in terms of execution, this is still going to be a game where individual mechanics, they require you to have the good individual mechanics, but teamwork at the end of the day, at the end of this game, who has the better teamwork on their side, they are going to have the 1 point that they're aiming for. It just advances the tournament.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think what you're trying to say here, Butters, is at the minimum, these two teams we have proven are mechanically gifted. Like, they are toe-to-toe, right? And prior to the playoffs starting, a lot of people would say Bren Esports were the favorites. And right now, Toadak is just equally able to eliminate them as the other. Mm-hmm. So, man, This pause might be the most gut-wrenching of all pauses in M2 so far.
It's the worst to see. It's the worst to see. But to answer your question, Contra, easily just look at Atlas and just look at Sylvana. Those are the two heroes that you need to keep your eyes on here, because no matter what, you're expecting Harley as well as the Farsa to dish out damage and Selena to get those picks. But if Atlas is just kind of hanging around, can't get those fatal links together, can't find that wombo combo to set things up, it's really not going to matter. And the same thing can be said about Moon on Sylvana.
That's right. Back in, you know, Season Y5 of the MPL MYSG, Atlas was very, very relevant, but it has definitely fell out of meta with things like, you know, Sylvana that we are currently seeing right now actually coming into play. And I just felt like it's just about these two trying to get those sort of big pickups, like you said. And there's a big bounty on that Harley's head. Who else could possibly go in for the catch if not for, you know, that Sylvana out there? And, you know, speaking of pauses here, back in M1, there's going to be those memes out there for Toadak. Toadak pause. So there's this running thing that going on for seasons after seasons.
It's a signature thing now.
I mean, it started in season 4, and that's when EVOS SG was able to get the championship win, and Torak was, you know, contesting them for it, and they only got first runner-up. A lot of pauses happened then, and from then on, since as season 5, it's just every single game in the MPL itself, just somewhere in between, the pause had to come in. I hope this isn't one of those situations.
Okay, so in fact, the pauses are actually spelled P-A-U-S without the E, because...
Paus.
Yes. Uh-huh. In Malay, paus or ikan paus is actually a whale. So, yeah, they definitely swim with the fishes, the swordfish.
Deep. But, deep.
Yeah, it definitely runs deep in the bay.
We're going deep.
Very, 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 very,
very deep. I'm seeing the draft here for both of the teams. I just have to say that I'm really expecting a lot from Flap.
Really?
Flap was phenomenal with Benedetta when he used it against Tennis Gaming.
True, true.
And I'm excited because we've seen a lot of Cyclane Benedetta go for the off-tank build with the Brute Force. Breastplate, the Oracle, the Queen's Wings. They don't go for the damage Benedetta. But Flap, when he played that hero, he just went full on damage. He got a Brute Force breastplate, that's for sure, but he just likes the damage all in all, and Flap Teasy here is with the Festival of Blood. He really just wants to get the Night Shield.
Oh, heck yeah. Let's see how they're going to play this out. Finally, we get into game. It's going to be Bren Esports versus Torak.
This is for sudden death, ladies and gentlemen. Both teams fighting for tournament life, and as expected, this is the laning we were looking for. Quite a big visit by E1 to the bottom lane. Lusty looking to catch someone as the Atlas, and that's going to be Moon being chased out. Poker trick here by Carl TZ, and rotation on the bottom lane. Flap TZ caught up by the Spiral Strangling. Oh, that's going to be the jump in. The perfect match. Moon dealing quite a bit of damage on Lusty. Few sets a trap underneath Moon, and they disengage. Oh, arrow misses.
Well, good sidesteps all across the board. I think you can definitely see how antsy everybody is. They're kind of tiptoeing around each other. It's like, I don't want to go too far. I don't want to get caught like this. You know, a single mistake could cost them so much more than they would expect.
Yep. Oh, that's a catch by Few, bursting down with the Garrot and the trap right after. An interesting duel situation here between Moon and him.
Yeah, both of them can't really push waves that fast, but, you know, they're going to try. But Carl TC, he's already level 4, and Moon at level 1. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Something's telling me he forgot to buy the mask.
Mm-hmm. So far, I'm liking that 4Maze has stuck to this. Again, when a team like Torak is put up against the wall, you know that they're sticking to their guns, because any team would have just crumbled and said, okay, just put Chico back in the jungle. Put Chico back in the jungle, but I think they really prepared for 4Maze this time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it looks like, you know, Moon, he was able to kind of purchase the mask. It's just that the wave had to crash in at time. But Butters, what do you think about the current situation of the game?
Looking at how they set up, they're trying to get the buffs as much as possible. Well, it's going to respawn in just a bit. Now the Harley is at the middle lane. He's just trying to clear out the waves. Mm-hmm. Now the blue buff is up.
Or
the purple buff is up.
Close.
For Bren Esports. And that is going to be the flame shot.
Close.
Almost taking down Chico.
One HP.
Now at least we're inside of Bren Esports. They're giving Chico problems. They might not have taken him down. But the thing is, he's forced to go back.
Yeah. An auto minus one now. Easy turtle take here by Bren Esports. Skyrocketing their gold lead up to 500 now. And they are trying to look engaged here. That's Moon caught with the deadly magics. Not enough other magic spells able to capitalize, and they disengage.
I got to give it to Bren. They are making sure they're covering their previous mistakes in game one, whereby they didn't really keep too much track on their waves. But now that they saw, okay, you know, Wanwan is going recalling back to base. There's no way she can push. Mm-hmm. We're going to the top side of the map where we can kind of monitor if they push too far and still get the turtle. Minimal loss, major profits all across the board.
Snap is... He's just contesting the farm of Chico.
Yep, here we go. Electo final blow used to clear the wave. Nice catch by Few. Purify here by Chico. Oh, from the back. Uh-oh. In comes Lusty. Then the
look
pop. The fatal lead. Caught easy in the back line. There's the deadly magic. Pew, pew, pew. And, oh, they missed it. There it is. The delay damage, first blood drawn. That's going to be the catch onto one. Carl Teezy.
Look at Flap.
Gets the brunt of the Imperial Justice now. Moon in the back running away. Flap Teezy once more. And there's not enough dashes in here to take down E1.
If he only had Electo Final Blow, that could have made all the difference in the world.
I mean, he had to get out of there. Come on. Unfortunately, like, it's one of those situations where you have to make the best of it no matter how you look. But they are going to get quite a lot of gold here off of those barriers from the turrets.
Mm-hmm. I like that Flap is not shy to use the Electo Final Blow because he did count that, hey, team fight just ended. I'm pretty sure maybe less than a minute from now, nothing's going to happen. But hold on. Up top, that's going to be X-Ray popping. The
car.
Oh! Beta Lynx at Lusty gets one. That's going to be X-Ray taken out, followed by four maze. Carl Teezy follows through. Two for none so far. Rebo escapes with just one HP.
And Moon is doing Moon things. He catches Carl Teezy
there's
once again.
Justice, but here comes Lusty to the rescue. And there's going to be an arrow. Oh! Oh! Moon! Moon goes down.
The plays are not working out for Todak's side. I mean, yes, they are succeeding in terms of the first initial catch, but Bren, they've got some really good responses. And honestly, can we get a counter for the entire of M2? How many people have survived with literally one HP? Because this has occurred way too often.
This just keeps happening, man.
Yeah.
And the backup, the response from the other teams is just being way too good. It's evolving into something that we can't even understand. Mm-hmm. Right now, Flap Teezy goes in.
Yep, E1 gonna be well charging out, but there is the period. There's the exclamation point. Now Chiku goes in with the crossbow. Tank takes one. Few is gonna go down, and here is the jump. Moon misses the Imperial Justice. Flap Teezy gets away, but will he live? There from the back, trying to poke him. There's the dash sword intent. Lusty now come in. Perfect match. Oh, is he gonna get it? He's gonna call it off. Not enough damage to waste. The links.
However, I mean, topside, they were able to break the top tier one, which is a huge win because Bren, now they are 5k ahead and they will be able to steal this away. Oh, yeah.
Retribution.
Oh. And that is a huge loss for 4maze. Thinking about it, the Roger runs on the dive mechanic 100% and what he needs is that orange buff. Now, without the orange buff, his damage output is lessened significantly. So now, Todak, what do they do about this? Do they force the fights or do they turtle?
Oh, it looks like it's Bren who's getting forced into a fight. Few here destroyed by 4maze, but there's the comeback. Atlas, Lusty, there's the Fatal Lynx. That's Moon going down. And from the back, Lapizzi with his own orange goes in trying to chase E1. But again, the blessing on Grok able to save him. Enough movement speed to retreat underneath his turret. Oh, but it's not done. X-Ray being chased out. That's gonna be one more from Flap Teezy. Y'all thought it was done, but it's not over. That's 4-4-1 in favor of Bren Esports.
Oh, what
no.
are you doing?
Oh, it's still not done. What? What? Here we go. Electric Boogaloo. The fight part two. Chiku goes for the crossbow tank. Flap Teezy gonna be the mark here. Oh, they're gonna be bouncing back. That's the flicker by Lusty, and they disengage.
Oh, Chiku, he's got the mechanics to keep himself alive and at least get one return kill, but overall, it's just wins across the board for Bren. They're 3k ahead. As we go into the seventh minute of the game, they're going to be able to start contesting for this turtle. I mean, Bren is doing a great job, and this snowball is still rolling.
Was that the best play? Probably not. They could have just taken down the turret. That could have gave them the opening to the jungle if they wanted to, but they just have to go for the kill.
Yep, here we go. This is Todak threatening the take underneath the turret. That's going to be one. Moon down by Flap Teezy. Another. It's a double for this young man, and he goes and gets E1 as well, and two for none for a turret? Is that worth it at this point?
Nope, not at all. I mean, they got the turret regardless, and it is mid-turret, which is important, but again, can they abuse its strategical effect at this point at being this far behind? And at the 21k mark here, going into 22, Bren is going to be able to hit their second item, and this is going to be a tough game here, and Todak is going to play a lot of catch-up for the next 5 minutes.
Demon Hunter Sword, though, is up on Chiku, so he's getting his items. Although the map isn't really sided to them in terms of control,
mm-hmm.
but at least Chiku is getting his items.
Yeah, so you're saying it's more Chico now than Formes, huh?
Yeah, it is.
All right, well, that's a push here by Brainy Sports. In
Chico gets caught.
Oh, no. That's going to be a couple of blasts from the Federer airstrike. And from the back, Formes catches Aribo and Moon as well. They're waiting. They're waiting. I think they know. Arrow thrown out here by Few. Oh, and the garage. That's going to be Aribo. Blasted down. Fatal Links onto one. Saves Aribo, but only for a second. E1 takes down the Farsa. And now Moon is the one who's next. Deadly Magic's being rained down upon. Oh, the strangling keeps him alive, but only for so long. One for one so far.
Oh, really good idea coming in from Moon. I'm pretty sure he's already purchased the concentrated energy to be able to get some major, major spell vamp there. Let's have a look. Yes, he does. But now, again, they need the Athena Shields. The Athena Shields are going to be so, so important in this game.
Looking at it, Carl TC goes for the Star Shard. That gives him the extra firepower that he needs. Flapteasy has a lot of items. And if you would look at Rebo right now with the Lightning Truncheon and the Clock of Destiny, even Few has the Clock of Destiny. I think he's going to go for Calamity Reaper. Next Dominance Ice is on Lusty. And on the other side, Chico here is probably planning to get an Athena Shield.
Hold up. Lusty finds him. That's two he caught. Oh, Fatal Link just underneath the turret. Arrow in by Few. That's going to be transformed, but it's not enough. Few gets him. Four Maze goes down, and it's only E1 left. X-Ray, I think he's abandoned his ally here. Off camera, Caldizzi takes down one. Chico is blasted. Feathered airstrike underneath the turret. E1 survives, but only for a second more. As Flapteasy, it's three different fights happening on three different fronts. And Flapteasy going to be disengaging. Oh my god, Brent is dominating. They're saying it's clobbering time.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and they're fighting. Oh, here we go. X-Ray, he's going to be popping off the Vengeance, but nothing is spell damage. Is that going to be enough damage? No, it is, and he is still good.
And while that's happening, the bottom lane gets cleaned up. There are no more outer turrets here. For the side of, there are no more outer turrets onto the bottom lane here. For the side of Todak and Bren Esports, 10 minutes in, they're going for the Lord. I don't think Todak can do anything about this.
Yeah, they're going for the throw here. They want to end this game as quick as possible to abuse how their comp has been working out thus far. But let's see how this fight is going to end up. They're on the run.
Nice use of the Feathered Airstrike. And now X-Ray caught out by the Flame Shot and Caldizzi finishing the job. Fatal Link onto one. Moon is looking low. He is going to get a few lifesteals from the Spiral Strangling, but will not survive anyways. Third one for Bren Esports. That's going to be E1. Chico is alive with less than half health. Triggers a crossbow tank underneath the turret, and Forme is not smart for him to engage here. And now Caldizzi finds him. He's able to blast him, but there's the counter go by the Farsa. That's one. Flapteasy gets the kill. Stacks on stacks on that Festival of Blood. One defender left for Todak.
Yeah, and this is it. Chico has to figure this out. Moon is coming back up in three. X-Ray in one. And they're going to back away just to kind of wait for this next upcoming Lord. Or at the very least, get another free pick. Because right now, Todak has been taking a lot of fights that they didn't need to take. And with 11k goalie on the side of Bren, they could really force another one if Todak get a little too angsty and force the fight again.
Look at Moon is just using that concentrated energy, and Bren Esports really hasn't gotten a deckness of Durant for that, so he'll get away with it, but he doesn't really have enough damage to supply that lifesteal with spell vamp rather. And looking at it, Flapteasy is just going 1v1 with Moon, and Moon, even though he had the chance to knock in Benedetta, he wouldn't, he just can't.
Close one on to E1 as well. If there was a Scorch on there somewhere, that would have been GG for the Grok. But right now, X-Ray as well pops the Cauldron Inferno just to survive. Goes back in. This is a surgical, a just methodical destruction of the base of Todak.
Mm-hmm. Yep, 13k ahead, and there we go. E1 doesn't have enough damage, but X-Ray keeps going in hard.
So many targets, so many people to steal life from, but instead he's bursted down. Caldizzi takes down the Thames. X-Ray, see you later. Now four defenders left in the base of Todak. This is dire. This is very close. This is scary. Hold on to your horses, ladies and gentlemen, because there's a Fatal Link here by Atlas. Lusty, that's going to be Few with the alley-oop. And now E1 from the back, destroyed by Rebo. And now it's just two of them left. Chiku and Moon, can they defend? Brand Esports is here to finish the job what they started. Now that's gonna be Chico with the crossbow tang. He's gonna come down and snap back to reality. Brand Esports takes game number three.
And Esports, ladies and gentlemen, finding the right adjustments, adapting from game number one. Whatever happened game number one, it was a wake-up call for them. And they go for the 2-1.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy, what a game that was. Really a great back and forth between the Filipinos and as well as the Malaysians. But unfortunately, it's going to be Bren moving on, carrying on the dreams of an entire nation. The Philippines smile upon them. But unfortunately for the region of MYSG, our region has been knocked out.
You know what? You can't say that we're happy, but at the same time, just looking at what the players sacrificed, at what the players did just to make it here, it also, for us, for me,